Welcome in the sixth lecture devoted to waves and optics. Here we are going to study electromagnetic waves. So we are going first to talk about energy, power and intensity of electromagnetic waves. Then we'll deal with radiation pressure, and then we'll talk about polarization. Our references are, as usual, our main book, Fundamentals of Physics, Giancoli also, and OpenStax Volume 2. So this is a summary of what we have seen in previous lectures. We will deal with electromagnetic sinusoidal waves in vacuum. Therefore, we have no charges in vacuum and no current. So in that case, we can write the electric field in this way, the magnetic field in this way. And remember, the electric field is perpendicular to the magnetic field, is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So the electromagnetic wave is a transverse wave. We have this relationship for the speed of light, for the speed of light in vacuum. So with the fundamental constant for magnetism and the fundamental constant for electricity. And we have this ratio E divided by B equals C. Okay, and we'll discuss that again. The direction of propagation can be expressed as E cross B, the direction. So the first question that we are going to address is what is the energy density at a given position and time? And for a traveling wave, what is the energy flux that we will call, in fact, the intensity? Let's start with the energy stored by an electric field and a magnetic field. And we start with the electric field and using a simple example, the capacitance. So what is the energy stored in a capacitance? So you know that formula, you have learned that in another course. So CV squared. So again, this is a typical shape for an energy. It is half of some property of your system and what is the variable, what is changing in your system, the excitation of your system. So C is the property of your device, the capacitance, and V is the excitation. So let's replace these two by some more fundamental variables. So C is epsilon zero, the area divided by the distance between the plates. And so V is ED. Okay, the electric field here is volt per meter, so you multiply by a distance, you get volts. And for the electric field inside the capacitor is constant, so we just multiply, so V is just ED. Right, so we have that. So we can simplify a little bit and we get a half of epsilon zero E squared and AD, which is a volume. Right, so in fact, this is a volume of your of your capacitor, of the space between the two plates, and you have that electric field in this volume. Right. So in fact, the energy density is this part. Okay, you just multiply by the volume to get the entire energy stored in that capacitance. So this is true for locally, for also for any region of space where there is an electric field. So you could do the same thing for the magnetic field. So what kind of device stores magnetic field? for example, an inductance. So if you do the same thing for an inductance, you probably know that also from another course on electromagnetism, you get U equal half again of that B squared divided by mu zero. And so again, the shapes are still the same. You have an energy equal half of something that is a property of your medium. So in this case, we are dealing with vacuum, multiplied by the excitation, which is here an electric field. And this magnetic field. This is a fundamental constant for electricity, and this one for magnetism. All right, so of course, in an electromagnetic wave, you have an electric field and also a magnetic field. So we add them together. This is our total energy density in our wave. So it's a sum of a contribution from the electric field and a contribution from the magnetic field. And this formula is for any instant t and at any position x. All right. So if you select this position, for example, you have to take into these formulas this electric field and this magnetic field, and it will be at this time t and that position x. So this changes very fast with time and with position. So remember that for an electromagnetic wave in vacuum, we have these two relationships. So in fact, here you can get rid of one of the electric field or the magnetic field and get an expression with only the electric field or only the magnetic field. And this is it. This is the expression only as a function of the electric field or only as a function of the magnetic field. So you can use also that one to have another variation. You can also have this. So it's a mixture of the two in this case. So here, an interesting also comment here. You see that the total energy is in fact epsilon zero E squared, but the contribution of the electric field alone was half of epsilon zero E squared. Therefore, it means that the contribution of the magnetic field is the same as the contribution of the electric field. They contribute the same to the total energy. Let's now establish the energy flux of the electromagnetic wave. So the energy flux is the energy transported per unit time and per unit area by a wave traveling at speed c in vacuum. So we call it s, and the unit is of course a joule per second per square meter. So let's consider a given area here. So this surface here has area S, area A. Alright, so we have to define an area because we are looking for something that is crossing a unit area, okay, per square meter and per second. So we also have to look at what is going on as a function of time, and we are going to look at the energy. So we consider that area A, and we look at what happens between t and t plus dt. And dt is, of course, as small as you want. So we consider, for example, here that E is a constant within the interval dt at this position in space. Okay, so we need an energy, joule. So let's look at... So the energy, in fact, that passes through A in time dt, this is what we are looking for, is in fact, looking at this drawing, is in fact the energy that occupies the volume shown by this gray box. So it has area A, and this thickness is delta x equals C delta T. So this energy will pass through that very thin length per unit area, per unit time. So that delta V is equal to A delta x equal A C delta T. Alright, so the total energy, so in that volume, is the density, energy density by the volume. Energy density, you know, it's epsilon zero is squared, and the volume is this. And now what is your flux? So your flux is in fact the energy per unit time and per unit area. So the area you considered here is A, so you have to divide this by A. And the time you consider here is delta t, so you have to divide also by delta t. Right, so S is delta u divided by A and also divided by delta t. So notice that this equation is universal for any kind of energy flux. So we are doing the calculation here for electromagnetic waves, but the way to do it for any kind of wave would be exactly the same. So in your book, it's done for the string, it's done also for sound. We do it here for electromagnetic waves. Alright, so delta U was given here, so you just divide by delta T and A, and you are left with epsilon 0 CE squared. This is your flux. Energy flux in joule per second per square meter, and of course joule per second is watt, so this is watt power unit. The unit for power, watt per square meter. All right, so because we have again these two formula, we can express S as a function of E only, B only, or E and B. All right, so what is the direction of wave travel? So we've said that already just before. It is given by E cross B. All right, and now you see that S is can be expressed as E multiplied by B. So it would be quite interesting to have one quantity that could give you the magnitude of the flux and also its direction at the same time. That is of course a vector. And so someone has invented this, and it is known as the pointing vector. So pointing was someone who probably had this idea. And that pointing vector therefore can be built from this cross product just by multiplying by 1 divided by mu 0. Alright, so this vector gives you the proper magnitude of the flux and the direction of the propagation of the energy. Right, so in fact it is quite interesting to notice that this vector, so the pointing vector, actually points to the direction of the energy flux, or the direction of the wave propagation. Okay, so it's a kind of interesting history coincidence. Alright, so this formula is at any instant t and any position. Okay, so S, as given by this expression, is something that is changing very quickly with time. If you take, for example, visible light, so you do run the calculation, you look in the tables, this corresponds to a frequency of like 10 to the 14 hertz. So you have an electric field and a magnetic field which is oscillating like 10 to the 14 times per second. So okay, you can say that we cannot observe this such a high change, high frequency change. So we are going to look for another quantity to use for our energy flux, something more practical. Alright, so let's define actually the intensity of an electromagnetic wave. So let's start with our energy flux. So it is given by this at any instant. We can replace the electric field by its sine function, like this. So we have to take the square given by this. So S is now given by this expression. And you see here clearly the dependence on X, position, and time T. So again, for visible light, for example, the frequency is extremely high. So it's not very practical. So if you just look at visible light, for example, it all depends on what your eye can see. For example, your eye cannot see a signal, so some light going down to zero and then going up again to some given value. If the time to go down and the time to go up is shorter than roughly 1 millisecond. So roughly, if the frequency of your signal is greater than, let's say, 1 kilohertz, corresponding to a period of 1 millisecond, you cannot see actually the signal go to zero and come back again to a given value. It will be too fast. It will not, your eye could not follow that signal. So it will not go down to zero at all in one period. So what you will see is an average, a kind of time average, okay, of that signal. So this is what we are going to do. We are going to calculate the time average flux. All right. So that will still be a flux, an energy flux, but just time averaged. So it will not depend on time anymore. We will average time. So it will still be in joule per second per square meter or watt per square meter. Okay, so just let's calculate that time average of this. So time is only in the electric field. So we only need to take the average of the sine square. All right. So we'll see that, or you can check that the average of a sine square is 1/2. Right, so we'll see that in the next slide, and this is something you can check or even calculate yourself. Therefore, it is a half of this. So if we replace this in the average of S, we get this. So this average of S is known as the intensity. This is the intensity, right? It does not depend on time. And also position here. It's just a property of your electromagnetic wave. So it's again a 1/2 of something related to your medium and wave. So medium epsilon zero, wave going at C. Speed C and with an amplitude EM squared. So again, you can express it as a function of the electric field and the fundamental constant of electricity, or everything related to the magnetic field. And of course, you can mix both. So notice also that you have C in it, so it gives you the per second that you need, and the rest is some energy. All right, so okay, so this is the intensity. So in your books, in some books, they use instead of this formula for the average intensity is average power transferred across a neutral area, They use the root mean squared instead of the maximum of the amplitude of the electric field. They use a kind of root mean squared, and the definition is the amplitude divided by square root of 2. Okay, so just know that, so be careful, it depends. Maybe in your assignments, they may ask you, but they will say if they want you to use the RMS or the amplitude. So this slide is just to show you the time average of the cosine squared. Actually, it will be the same for a sine squared. This is the definition of the average, so the time average in this case for a function. So if you take the integral over one period, like here, so the cosine will vary from 0 to 1, and the mid value will be 1/2, and you see that basically you have to calculate the integral. So you see that that function spends half of its time below 1/2 and half of its time above, right? So it's easy to see here that the average will be 1/2, right? But you can also calculate it's just the integral of cos squared, so it's not difficult. Let's take an example that we may find in our daily life. For example, a laser that has an intensity of about 1 milliwatt per square meter. So it's a small laboratory, so you have a low power. Well, I think there is no correlation between the size of the laboratory and the power of your lasers, but okay, let's continue with this. So, assuming the beam is composed of plane waves, calculate the amplitude of the electric and magnetic fields in the beam. So, of course, because we have the intensity, and we know that it is related to the magnetic, the intensity of the electric field by this equation, we are going to just use that equation. So, the electric field, therefore, is given by this equation. We just replace by the right numerical values. And we find 0.87 volt per meter. So it's not a very large voltage, electric field. And, okay, so equation, okay, you just use the same equation or with the magnetic field, or you use the relationship between B and E. Like this, and you find the intensity of the magnetic field. Alright, so you see that they are quite different. This is close to 1, and this is 10 to the minus 9. So it's a nano. It's 2.9 nanotesla. So it looks like the magnetic field is very small. This is a very small number. But in fact, remember that the energy carried by the electric field is the same as the energy carried by the magnetic field. So this effect, this difference in magnitude is just a unit effect. The Tesla is a large unit. So you need very small pieces of a Tesla in order to have a magnetic field that we can observe. All right. Let's talk again about the variation of the intensity with distance. This is something that we have already seen in a previous lecture. So this is a point source that is emitting at a given power in joule per second. And the thing is, what is the intensity at a given distance r? So of course, because of conservation of the energy, the flux through that area should be the same as the flux emitted by the source. Therefore, you have the power equals intensity by the area that you are considering. The area perpendicular to the flow of direction. To the flow direction. Okay, so remember this formula. And for a point source, of course, that area is 4 pi r squared. So we have here a relationship between the intensity at any point in space as a function of the power emitted by the point source. Let's take another daily life example for the light emitted by a light bulb. Even though light bulbs are becoming quite rare and they are replaced by they get replaced by light emitting diodes, which are more efficient. Okay, so let's see. We have a light bulb emitting 5 watts. So light bulb can be considered a point source. 5 watts of power as visible light. So you know that light bulb can emit actually a lot of infrared. So this is only 5 watts of visible light. What are the average electric and magnetic fields from the light at a distance of 3 meters? So strategy, yes, the bulb is a point source. Therefore, its emission is isotropic. And the intensity will be the same everywhere in space, in all directions, at 3 meters. So we can use actually the formula that we have seen in the previous slide, which is this one. And I is given also by this. So here we have the electric field as a function of the power. So we can just calculate that. And we find 5.77 newton per coulomb. Another interesting unit for the electric field. And the magnetic field is 1.92 10 to the minus 8 Tesla. So again, you see the very big difference in the number. A very low number here compared to the number for the electric field, but again, it is due to the choice of units. Alright, so significance is just to point out this R squared. The intensity drops very quickly with distance. Okay. So in fact, you know that your phones carries so when you send a signal, whatever, a conversation or an email, or you are surfing the net, your phone is sending some electromagnetic waves everywhere in space, and it obeys roughly this equation. It's not exactly a point source, but you can as a first approximation, you can say your phone emits this kind of intensity. So it has a given power. And then the intensity at a distance R from your phone is given by that. And it drops very quickly. So in fact, companies, phone companies, internet carrier providers, companies, they have to relay your signals many times. So there are many detectors of your signal, and they re-amplify that and they send it again, etc. So there are many relays before eventually your signal gets into some optical fiber and goes away across the oceans sometimes to get to your to the destination. Okay. So you need quite high power in order to have a high intensity at a given distance. Let's now introduce radiation pressure. So in fact, an electromagnetic wave carries energy, so that we have already seen that, but it also carries momentum. So whenever you have momentum, you can have a force. So in this case, a pressure. So you may know already that the duality on a wave particle, that light can also be represented using a particle framework. So where light is supposed to be composed of photons. So photon as a particle carries energy and momentum. All right. So electromagnetic waves carry momentum and they can push on surfaces. So let's look here at a very specific example case. Okay, it's not a general case, it is very specific. The electromagnetic wave is incident on a metal in which electron motion is damped by the resistance of the metal, so that the average electron motion is in phase with the force causing it. So in fact, if you apply an electric field, even a changing magnetic field, the electron will nicely just follow that electric field. Okay, with no delay, no lag, it just follows nicely. So in such a case, look at this. So this is an wave coming in this. This is a metal surface. So let's look at an electron here at the surface of this metal. Here you have so it's at this position you have this electric field. So it is at a maximum here. So the electron responds to the electric excitation. So you know F equal minus E E. So I will print that. I will write that. So the force is on the electron due to the electric field will be minus E E. Okay. And this, of course, is a vector. So the force will be in this direction. Therefore, the velocity will also be downwards in this case. Okay. So if you have your electron moving and you have a magnetic field, so it's an electron moving in a magnetic field. Therefore, you have Lorentz force. Right. So if you look carefully at the direction of the Lorentz force, which is in the direction of V cross B, negative because you have to put the minus C, so it is this one. Okay. Right. So you have a force that is pointing inside the metal, so in the direction of the wave travel. So the wave is pushing on the metal surface. So this is a very particular example, but Maxwell's equation together with the Lorentz force equation implies the existence of radiation pressure in general. So let's establish some formula for this radiation pressure. So the electromagnetic wave carry energy and momentum P. So the energy transferred, the transferred momentum delta P is given by this equation. So why is that? Okay, so let's see where this is coming from. You know Newton's second law. The force is equal to dp dt. Okay, this is just Newton's second law. Then you know that conservative forces derive from a potential. So F equal minus du dx. U is the potential energy. Alright, so from that, you can isolate dp, which is delta p in our case. So delta p equal minus delta u dt. So you multiply by dt this whole thing, dt divided by dx, which is the inverse of dx divided by dt, which is the inverse of c. All right. So you have dp equal du divided by c, which is just what we get here. So we have something in a number in front. So this is to take into account whether you have fully reflected waves, in such a case you have A equal 2, or fully absorbed wave, in this case A equal 1. So the difference is in a collision. So in this case you would have the wave or a photon colliding with a surface. And when you have a collision, you know that you can have elastic collision, conservation of momentum and energy, or inelastic collision, where you only have conservation of momentum. So at least you always have conservation of energy, but not mechanical energy. So in fact, it is the same story here. When you have a full reflection, it's like an elastic collision, and all the momentum is transferred to the surface, if it is a normal incidence. Normal is the wave is going perpendicularly to the surface. If you have an inelastic collision, you will have energy lost in heat and maybe other things in the material. And in that case, you don't have the transfer momentum is different, and you have A equal 1 in this case. For a fully absorbed, of course, you can have, in general, you have something in between. And therefore, A will be in general, between 1 and 2. All right, and this, of course, is taken for a time delta t, because you have a delta p and delta u, so this is for a time delta t. So what is the pressure, p, exerted by radiation on an object? So the pressure is a force per unit area, it's newton per square meter. All right, so first we need the force, so let's take Newton's second law, F equal dp dt. We will have dp coming from that. So we have du here, so what can we say about du? So du appears in the intensity. Okay, so this is delta u is energy transported in time delta t. So this is the average flow, average rate of energy flow, joule per second. This thing. Right, and this is therefore the intensity multiplied by the area that you consider. Okay, because this is the energy flux in joule per second and per square meter. So you need to multiply by the area of the surface you are considering. Okay, so let's continue. Pressure equals force divided by the area. Force taken from this, so it's delta p divided by a dt. You can replace your delta p by this. So you have all that. You have your delta u divided by delta t, which is just this. So you just replace this by that. And you get that your pressure is equal to AI divided by C. So it's proportional to the intensity, to the flux of energy. Okay, so you can write it like that, noticing that the intensity is just the average, time average of the Poynting vector magnitude. So do you think we can use this force from the sun? From the sun, for example, to move some objects around, like to sail. So in space, sailing with the sun's pressure is actually something that is considered. And so let's see the orders of magnitude here. We look at the intensity of energy of the sun at a distance of 1 AU, so this must be an astronomy unit, astronomical unit from the sun, but it won't play any role here because we have the intensity already, so we don't need to calculate anything with this length. It's okay, this number in watt per square meter. The light sail spacecraft has sails with sails, okay, like a boat, has sails using the wind, with total area of 32 square meters, okay, reasonable, and a total mass of 5 kilos, so it's a small boat, a small spacecraft. It can be a probe, Okay. Calculate the maximum acceleration light sail spacecraft could achieve from radiation pressure when it is about that distance from the sun. Strategy. Okay, so indeed, the maximum acceleration can be expected when the sail is open directly, of course, facing the sun to maximize the area exposed to the sun. Use the light intensity to calculate the radiation pressure, of course, from it. The force on the sails, then of course you want the acceleration, so you go to the Newton's second law to calculate the acceleration. Alright, so the radiation pressure is F equal PA. Okay, P is in this case the pressure. Okay, PA. So this is, don't worry about it, this is U is an energy. So don't worry about it, it is just I divided by C. So you don't worry about that, just use that P is 2i divided by CA. The two, it doesn't really matter, but okay, you have, let's say your cells are perfect and they reflect perfectly the sun. So you need, you put the two. Okay, the difference if this is not a two would just be a factor of two. It would not be a big problem for this order of magnitude. Okay, so you replace the I is this, the area is this, and the speed of light hasn't changed. We are in vacuum, and this is what you obtain. So it's a small force, but let's see the resulting acceleration. So F divided by M, we get that. So it's not a fantastic acceleration, but if you wait long enough and imagine that the power will stay the same as you move away. So this is the significance. If this acceleration continues for a year, the craft would attain a speed of roughly 2000 meters per second. Okay, which is huge. 2 kilometers per second. Okay, you have to wait a year, but well, when you send a probe in space, you are not especially in a hurry, so it's better than nothing because it doesn't cost anything. Let's take another example. This is Halley's Comet. So it's a comet here. So when you observe it, you see it like that. So you have the, of course, the big thing is there, the nucleus. And you see this, so this is becoming quite hot when it is close to the sun and it melts, etc. So some pieces are getting out of the comet. So you see this nice tail. There is another tail, a gas tail here. So you see that it is tilted compared to the dust tail. So here we have two effects. The gas tail, in fact, is made of kind of plasma, so ionized particles, ionized molecules, and it is like that. So let's say the comet is going, let's say this way, like this. So I will take maybe a pen. In fact, I would say the comet is probably going roughly that way. And the sun is somewhere here, okay. Emitting everywhere in space. So in fact, this the sun also emits the so-called solar wind, which is a flow of ionized particles. So this gas interacts with these ionized particles, and it pushes it away like that. So you have it pushed away compared to the trajectory of the comet. So what we are interested in here is the dust tail. Here you see that it is also moved compared to the trajectory of the comet. And this is a small effect due to the radiation pressure of the sun on this dust. Okay, so this is something that can be that was observed when Halley's comet came close to the Earth. So let's do a small calculation. So Halley's comet was actually something that was a big thing in 1986 when it came close to the sun. Okay. So let's take the average power output of the sun as 3.8 10 to the 26 watt. So this is like a point source emitting at this power. Calculate the radiation pressure on the comet at this point in its orbit, so at this distance. Assume that the comet reflects all the incident light, therefore you use A equal 2, okay, because full reflection. Okay, and then we will see the B later on. So in this case, it would be just a small piece of material to 10 kilo for 10 minus 2 square meter breaks loose and calculate the force. So this is the tail. This object would be in the tail of the comet. And compare that with the gravitational force of the sun. Halley's comet. Okay, so strategy: calculate the intensity of the solar radiation at a given distance from the sun and use that to calculate the radiation pressure. So use okay. Our formula, which is this one. All right, so the intensity, remember we have to use it's a point source, so total power emitted divided by the area at this distance. So so it is divided by 4 pi r squared. Okay, and we find this. So it's a kilowatt per square meter. Okay, quite large. Assuming the comet reflects all the incident, yes, so we use 2 here. And we replace everything in it, and we find 10 minus 5 newton per square meter. Okay, this is our pressure. So B, let's do that now for that small piece of chunk. So F equal pressure by area. Area is this. Okay, we find 10 minus 6 newton. Micronewton. Whereas the gravitational force of the sun, so you can use the Newton's formula here, 0.16 newton. So the gravitational force of the sun on the chunk is therefore much greater than the force of the radiation. So which should say that the chunk should be attracted by the sun more than repelled, in the sense due to the radiation. So this drawing shows what happens. Like the sun is here, you have the comet going in a typical orbit. And you have the gas tail here that is really very much influenced by the sun, and the dust tail, which of course the dust tail, like the comet, is the subject subjected to the gravitation. But in addition to that, you have that radiation pressure, which tends to blow it away. Like this. Let us now move to polarization. So, for example, let's take some TV signals. It looks like TV antennas are oriented vertically in England and horizontally in the USA. Why? Remember what we have seen in the previous lecture. We had an antenna, and this antenna was used to produce electromagnetic waves. So this is an emitter. In that case, the antenna is an emitter. But it can also be used as a receiver. Okay, many things are reversible in physics. And something that is an emitter. When you use an antenna as an emitter, you run a current through it. You have a generator here, an AC generator. So you have an oscillating, you drive an oscillating current in this antenna and you generate a wave. So now you have the opposite. You have an electromagnetic wave coming, interacting with that antenna, and you don't have any generator here. You have a receiver. You just look at what's going on in this antenna. let's take this example. The antenna is oriented, let's say, vertically in this case, and you have an electromagnetic wave coming like this. So with the electric field oriented vertically. So this electric field will act on the electrons in this metal antenna and let them move. All right. So the electrons, when they move, they create a current. Okay, so you have a current as a response to your electric field. And because the electric field changes with time at this position, you will have an oscillating current in this, and you can detect that. So you can therefore collect the energy, let's say, of that electromagnetic wave in the form of some electrical energy in the circuit. And you can collect any kind of signal carried by that wave, in particular TV signals. All right, so the direction of the electric field with respect to the antenna is in fact very important, because if your electric field is perpendicular to the page, in this case, the electrons in this rod will not be excited. They will not run vertically. Okay, because the force will be out of page, so they will have very limited motion perpendicularly to the page, and you will not get that oscillating current. So the direction of the electric field is very important. And this is the direction of the electric field is the can be named called the polarization. Okay, so let's see some animation showing how antennas work. So this is an animation of showing how antennas work. So you have here on the left a transmitter. So some wave will be generated by this antenna. And you have very far away here on the mountain, you have a house, and probably someone would like to watch TV, so they have installed an antenna on the roof. Alright, so let's say that now there is something interesting to broadcast, and the transmitter is emitting some wave. So let's say it is just a fixed frequency, to make it simple, so it's a very simple signal. So here now these arrows and the curve shows the force on the electron. So of course you you drive an electron, so it oscillates here. Okay, so the arrows show the force on the electron. So you see the electron is responding to that force. And so let's start it again. Stop this. And let's see. So at first, you have this is put on, but this one does not oscillate yet. When the wave reached that point, now it is oscillating. So in fact, the electrons in this antenna are responding to the electric field brought by the wave. So you can here get the signal, whatever signal that was emitted by the transmitter. Here you can see in this small window, you can see the oscillation in the transmitter and the signal in the receiver. So you have a nice sine wave here and also at the receiver. So you notice that the amplitude at the receiver is lower than that at the transmitter. So this is normal if so you put a given power in this transmitter, and if the power is emitted, if the emission is isotropic, then you know that the intensity very far away will vary with distance, like something divided by R squared. So of course your intensity will be lower and your electric field will be lower at a distance. Right, so what can we do? We could change the frequency, we could change the amplitude with these. We can look at the full field. This shows only a wave that is going perpendicular, moving perpendicularly to the antennas, but the field of course is everywhere in space. All right, so let's see what happens in this page, in the 2D plane of the page field. Yeah, so this would be the electric field everywhere in the at least in the cross section represented by the page. And this is still the force. So the electric field is just minus that divided by the charge of the electron. Okay, so you see that in some region of space, let's say here, if you see my mouse, it oscillates from an upward vector to a minus, so it just oscillates. Here. Okay. Curve plus vectors. Alright, so that's it. So you see this is an emitter, this is a receiver. Okay, so let's look at another demonstration. So this one is from MIT Physics Lecture. So you have here a power source and a transmitter. So this is the emitter. It is parallel to the ground. Like that, and this is the receiver, right? And it is connected to a bulb. So this part of the antenna is connected to a wire that runs through the bulb and then connected to the other side. So you see that when the two antennas are parallel, you have some electricity going through that bulb, and when it is perpendicular, you do not have any electricity running through this wire in the bulb. So this shows the phenomenon of polarization. You see the electric field which runs parallel to the ground cannot excite, for example now, cannot excite any electrons in this antenna when it is vertical. And when it is parallel to the transmitter, of course it can some electrons can move around in the detector, and that electricity is detected by the bulb. So for electromagnetic waves, the plane containing the electric field, E, is called the plane of oscillation of the wave. You could have chosen B, in fact, but when you know one vector, you know the other one, so one is enough, right? So in general, we use the electric field as the plane of oscillation. So obviously polarization can exist only for transverse wave, right? Because it is a direction that is perpendicular to the direction of motion of the wave. So there is a so-called unpolarized waves. So in not only in electromagnetic waves, but especially in electromagnetic waves. So what does it mean? It can be represented by this, for example. So this wave is traveling along the x-axis. And you see that the electric field is always changing direction. Okay, so it is actually represented here. So this is yz, so y is perpendicular, let's say, in this direction. And z is up. And you have at a given time, you may have at a given position. So, okay, let's say pen. So this position, let's say, it could be, for example, at this position. So at some point, you have... So now let's say it is oriented up like that. But at another, so this wave is of course traveling in this direction. So at some point your electric field will be like that, for example, etc. So this shows just at one point in space, at different times, your electric field. And this shows at a given time and at a different position in space your wave, therefore your electric field. Okay, so this you see that the direction is always changing, so it's not a polarized wave, it is an unpolarized wave. So how you make that? The generation of the wave is an oscillator, remember? But you can generate a wave with an oscillator. So imagine an oscillator that is constantly changing direction. Okay, now is up, let's say, and a bit later it will be horizontal, etc. So, and randomly, a kind of random process. So random processes will lead to unpolarized waves, like random processes like the emission of light from the sun, so the sun emits unpolarized wave. A tungsten lamp with bulb, a light bulb, will also it's just emission of a hot body, so you will have also unpolarized light. Also notice that we have already discussed the fact that for visible light, let's say the frequency is 10 to the 14 Hertz, so these changes cannot be observed. They are too fast to be observed in usual circumstances. So in fact, the electric field is randomly varying on a time scale that is much shorter than that needed for our observation. Okay, so you don't really notice the difference between a visible light that is unpolarized or polarized. Okay. So we will see that polarized light has some very special properties, of course, and these properties, of course, can be observed. Right. Okay, so this slide is very important. So please focus and understand this. It is very, very important. So an unpolarized we are going to show this, that an unpolarized wave can be viewed as a superposition of two waves polarized perpendicular to each other with respective intensities half of that of the original wave. So let's see. We have this consider a wave associated to the electric field E. Okay, so at a given time, that electric field is shown in red here. So it is unpolarized, so it always changes with time. Okay, and it is traveling, of course, in the x direction, which is out of page. Which is out of page towards us. So the intensity is proportional to E squared. We've seen that. So we can always, when you have a vector, you can always decompose it into two perpendicular components. All right, so in this case, you can say E equal EY plus EZ. They are perpendicular, two components. And You can express EY as a function of E and the angle theta. And same story for EZ. So in fact, this is just the superposition principle. The wave can be considered as a sum of two waves. So in this case, associated to EY and EZ with intensities. So they will have their own intensities, these two waves, IY and IZ. And these intensities are proportional to EY squared and EZ squared. Therefore, you will have IY proportional to so the amplitude of the wave E, so which it should be E squared and cosine squared theta, so proportional to this squared. Okay, and same story for IZ, but this time it is the sine. Alright, so again, so it depends on theta, and theta depends on time, because this is unpolarized, so E is always changing, so at a given time you have that, but at another time you will have, let's say, it will be here, at another time, and theta will be different. So if you look at a long time, you will see that all angles will be scanned by the electric field. The electric field will take any value, all the values available, if you wait a long time, if you wait long enough. So what we can do here, we look at the average. So on average, for unpolarized light, all angles have the same probability to be observed. Okay, so we take the angle average. So what is the angle average of that, of IY? IY, so it is the angle average. So this is a constant. So this doesn't need anything. So this will we need to average the cosine square of theta. So remember, when we looked at the definition of the intensity, we took the time average of the pointing vector, and we had a cosine square in it, and we had and the average was 1/2. So it's the same story here. We just instead of the time, we take the average over the angle. But the result is the same. You have an average which is 1/2. Okay, and same story for of course the sine squared theta. It will give you just a half. So in the end, what you have is that the average of this wave is just I, so the intensity of the initial wave, that one, divided by 2. Okay. Because this, again, is the same as that. Huh? Okay. The intensity is proportional to the electric field of the wave. And same story for IZ. So we have shown just this, and this is very useful. An unpolarized wave can be viewed as a superposition of two waves perpendicular to each other, so polarized waves. Okay, you start with an unpolarized and you decompose it into two polarized waves just perpendicular to each other, and each of these two waves carries half the energy of the original wave. Okay, so this is extremely useful when we deal with polarizers that we are going to see soon. All right, let's just show different polarization states. Unpolarized, so it's a random orientation of the electric field. So because it can be decomposed into two orthogonal polarized waves, sometimes it is symbolized like this. We just represent an unpolarized wave with two polarized waves perpendicular to each other, like that. So this is polarized light, so just for example vertical, okay. And this is an example of circularly polarized light. So you see that it is the electric field is actually rotating around the axis of propagation. So this is it can be achieved by taking two polarized waves, orthogonal like this, but one wave has a phase shift compared to the other one. Okay, so if it has a phase shift, it will produce this kind of rotation. And if in addition to that the amplitude is different, so the horizontal would have a different amplitude compared to the vertical, then instead of circular wave, you would have an ellipsoidal wave. It would, if you look in front here, instead of a circle, you would get an ellipsoid. Alright, so common sources like the sun, the light bulb, I have already stated this, emit randomly polarized or unpolarized light. And polarized light is actually emitted by special sources like lasers. Okay. Even like laser pointers, they are polarized in general. Let's now introduce polarizers. So here, in fact, we can use a string. So this is a polarized wave with a vertically polarized wave, and this is a horizontally polarized wave. So you see that if we place a kind of slit on the way, so this does not disturb at all this wave, so it goes through. But when the polarization is horizontal, here you see that it prevents the horizontal oscillation. Okay, if your slit is sufficiently narrow, here your rope cannot oscillate in this direction, in the horizontal direction, and therefore your polarization, your wave cannot go through that slit. Okay. So this is a so-called polarizer, because it lets through one type of polarization only. So if your rope was shaken not horizontally or and not horizontally but just with an angle, only some vertical part will be transmitted. Okay. So we will see that with the electromagnetic waves. So let's see now some different types of polarizers for electromagnetic waves. So this is the most probably famous. It's a so-called wire grid polarizer. So it's you have a substrate. So this could be whatever, some piece of glass, for example. And on it you have some aluminum ribs, some lines of metal. Okay. So your unpolarized light is arrive like this on this thing, and it can be, as we said, decomposed into let's say horizontal and vertical. So here we call the P polarized light the horizontal one, and the S polarized light the vertical. Okay, these are typical names used in optics. So what happens? So let's take the horizontal part, so which is the P polarized. So it oscillates horizontally. So electrons in these metal rods, they can oscillate. Okay, this is a metal. There are many free electrons in it, so they can oscillate like the antenna. So this is a kind of antenna. In fact, in itself, this piece of material. And so what happens is that they oscillate and they re-emit the electric field in vacuum, let's say in air. And because you have, so you have in the process, you must have conservation of energy and momentum. So it's like a collision. So if you, let's say you had some particles coming here and they bounce out of this wall, it would just bounce back with a similar angle. So it's a specular reflection. Okay, so you would have, for example, let me take the pen. Okay, so this angle would be the same as the incident angle. Okay, that one. Okay. So this is like conservation of momentum for a collision. Alright, so this is what is going on. So, however, for the vertical component, so the S-polarized light, so you see that the motion of the electrons is very limited in the vertical direction. Okay, these metal rods are very thin. Okay, so it's like the slit for the rope. So the electrons cannot oscillate, so they do not absorb the light, and the light just go through it. Okay. And so in the end, here incident you have unpolarized light, and the transmitted light is polarized. It is the S polarized light only because the P polarized was reflected. Okay, and the intensity. So if the intensity is I here, this one will be I divided by 2, about. Okay, for an ideal polarizer. Of course, it's not always exactly this, and it may depend on the wavelength, etc. So if you want more information, actually, you can look at that. I will put this file in NUCT. All right. So this is another type of polarizer. This is an absorptive polarizer. So in this case, you also have unpolarized light incident. And let's say the horizontal polarization is absorbed in the material. So at the exit, the horizontal has been, there is no intensity related to the horizontal component of the electric field. But however, the vertical component is allowed to go through with a little absorption inside the material. Right? Okay. So this polarizer lets through only the polarization that is, let's say, along this vertical direction. So if you use another polarizer, similar, but you rotate it by 90 degrees so that it allows through only the electric field that is horizontal, then you see that you will also cancel this vertical component, and at the end you will have nothing left. So what happens here is, in fact, one component is absorbed, and the energy is converted to heat in that material. So you see that it is not an ideal way to polarize light, because your material should get hot, and eventually, if you don't have a cooling system of some sort, you will burn your material. So this is reserved to low powers, low light powers, and for cheap applications. So low light intensities and cheap applications, like display doesn't, they don't need a high power, so it's enough. Uh, Let's see how this absorption can take place. Usually, these so-called absorptive polymers, polarizers, are made of kind of polymers, so they are quite cheap. So what happened is that you have polymers are usually made of long molecules. So if you manage to have these long molecules oriented in a given direction, like this, these molecules will absorb so some electrons in this, or the charges in this chain will respond to the electric field that is in the same direction as the molecule. Okay, so it will excite, let's say, some vibrations or things like that. So the energy is converted to heat, mainly in this material. So if you have a thick sample, thick enough to absorb all the light, then you have only the vertical component will get through. Okay, because the vertical component does not interact with these molecules. Okay, as shown in this, so they do not excite any much, let's say, in the vertical direction. So the wave can get through. So let's now see what is the intensity after you put a polarizer in front of a wave. So we have already said that if you start with unpolarized light, and then you put a polarizer in front of it, you will transmit only one of these two components. And we have seen just before that for unpolarized light, each component, considering orthogonal polarization, each component carries half of the original energy. So after a polarizer, so you have unpolarized light first incident, and after a polarizer, your intensity is half of the original intensity. Okay, so this is very important. You have to know that. Then let's play. You can add several polarizers. So you have first unpolarized light here. You put a vertical polarizer. So these lines are supposed to show what is transmitted by the polarizer. So you have a vertical. Now you have a plain polarized light after this polarizer. So if you put a horizontal polarizer like this, what is the intensity after that? So we have discussed that just before, actually. So because this polarizer transmits only the polarization that is horizontal, you do not have any horizontally polarized light here. So this and the vertical will be totally absorbed. So there is no light after that. So you can completely extinguish or quench some light by putting two polarizers that are perpendicularly aligned. Okay. So now, what is... let's say that the electric field... So you have polarized light now. Okay, so it is... the electric field, so the polarization, is a... makes an angle theta with the vertical. And you put a vertical polarizer. So now there is an angle between the electric field and the polarization that is allowed to get through that polarizer. Okay, and it is theta. Here we have an original intensity I0. So the question is, what is the intensity after the polarizer? Okay, so after the polarizer, of course, your electric field will be oriented vertically, because that polarizer allows for only vertical electric fields. So what happened is that you can use the superposition principle again and say that this wave represented by E0 can be considered to be the sum of two waves associated to EY and EX, so two perpendicular components, and only the Y component is transmitted. Okay. So this means that only this vertical component will be transmitted, and the value is E0 cos theta. So your electric field here, after the polarizer, has become E0 cos theta and is vertical. So what is the energy? Energy is proportional to the electric field. Okay. So this was proportional to I0 squared. Okay, so here now our intensity is proportional to I0 squared and cos squared theta. Okay, and of course this is related to I0, so in fact I equal I0 and multiply by this cosine squared theta. Okay, so sorry, I draw above the formula. So it's I equal I0 cos squared theta. Okay, so this will be an extremely useful formula also to solve problems. So let's play a little bit with these polarizers. So we have seen already that when you have unpolarized light, after a polarizer you have polarized light, and if you put a polarizer again perpendicular to the first one, then there is no light. Okay. So what happens if you take that same system and you put another polarizer in between, like this? And this one is oriented 45 degrees compared to the two others. So what is intensity in this case, here? Okay, so you can think about it. In fact, it is this. It's not zero, okay? Which is quite interesting. So let's see what happens here. Here, so let's say the intensity is I1 here. So we start with unpolarized light, with intensity I0. So after a polarizer, you have polarized light and half the intensity. Okay, nothing new here. Then here, this, let's call that I2. So I2, you have, so the polarizer makes an angle 45 degrees with this polarized light. So you have to use our formula. I2, so here, equal intensity here, which is I1, cos squared of the angle between the light, polarization of the light and the polarizer, which is 45 degrees. And this is 1/4. So this is 1/2, actually the square. Therefore, because I1 was already I0 divided by 2, we have I2 equal I0 divided by 4. Okay, so let's continue to the next step here. So this is I3. So I3, now you see you have, we have to apply the same equation. And the angle here between the horizontal and the 45 will be also 45. Okay. So I3 will be I2 cos squared 45 degrees again. Therefore, it will be I2 divided by 2, and therefore I0 divided by 8. So let's look at an application, which is a liquid crystal display. So you have here an example. So you have first here a polarizer oriented like that. So this grid is supposed to be a polarizer in this direction, and you have another polarizer here in the perpendicular to that one. Okay, so like this. And then you have so some electrodes. You have an electrode here and another one here. So, and in between you have your liquid crystal, which is made of some molecules, long molecules, which can rotate like that. So in fact, this is the situation when there is no applied electric field between the two electrodes. So you see it's opened. And the molecules are oriented like that. So they rotate naturally. So your, let's say your, you have some light, polarized light. So anyway, even if it's not polarized, it will be polarized after this polarizer, oriented like this. And all these molecules act a little bit like polarizers themselves. So they allow for the rotation of the light, of the polarization. So here, at the exit, here your light is now polarized in this way. Okay, so it has been rotated. The polarization has been rotated from this direction to this direction, and because that polarizer is also in the same direction, the light is going through. Okay, so light goes through. Now, if you apply a voltage to that liquid crystal, the molecules can move. That's why it's called a liquid crystal. So you can the molecules are allowed to move when you apply an electric field, and in particular they can move in this way. So now you see that the light does not interact at all with these molecules because they are oriented vertically now, and your electric field is oscillating horizontally. So again, it's like these antennas. Here, these antennas do not absorb any light. So the light just go through. But now, because the incident light is polarized in this way, and your polarizer there is orthogonal to that direction, so this polarizer will stop all the light, and nothing will go through. Okay. So with that, you can get a dark image or a bright image. Okay. So this is how a typical black and white, for example, display can work. And for colored display, you just use some more complicated devices where you can also choose a color that is going through. This is the end of this lecture. So this is a summary of everything you need to know and remember. E and B contribute half of the total energy of the wave. The pointing vector is represents the flux of the energy, and it also shows the direction of propagation of the energy, and this is at any instant t. So then we define the average power transferred across the unit area. So we took the time average of this to get the intensity, which is given by this formula. The intensity is also can be expressed in terms of total emitted power and the area perpendicular to flow direction. And you should know, of course, the easy case of a point source. We have seen radiation pressure given by this. We have also seen polarization. So this, remember this, unpolarized wave is a superposition of two polarized waves perpendicular to each other, and with half, each one carrying half of the original wave intensity. So this is shown here. In unpolarized light with intensity I0, then polarized light with only half of the intensity. And this is the formula that you should remember when there is an angle between the polarization, incident polarization, and the polarizer.